Hello everyone. For today's webinar, we will see how design can be driven by functional specification. This allows non-specialists to optimize parts or assemblies and to engineer lightweight products. To explain this cognitive augmented design, I'm delighted to welcome Daniel Pizac, who is the director of the Worldwide Center of Excellence for CATIA Mechanical Systems Modeling and Simulate. Thank you to those who already sent us questions. Daniel will answer them after his presentation, and we will also publish all your questions and answers in the CATIA user community with the webinar recording. This is where you can ask new questions if you want, and we will answer you. Or you can write to catia.contact@3ds.com if you prefer an email response. Please also note that in 2 weeks, we will have our second part of our series on CATIA, what's new on CATIA design in R2019X, and this second part is on surface refinement. I hand over to Daniel now and wish you a very inspiring webinar.
Thank you very much, Anne, for this introduction. Thank you for attending this TV show. It's a pleasure to be here. Now, when you see the title, Cognitive Augmented Design, the revolution has started, you probably ask yourself, what does it mean by cognitive augmented design, and why is it a revolution? This TV show is just about giving you an explanation about that. Let's start. CATIA V5 has been introduced long time ago, in end of 1898, and it was already a revolution, feature-based, parametric, so what we call computer-aided design with a full maturity. And then we improve CATIA V5, we add some knowledgeware capability in order to standardize, to incorporate company know-how, to automate the design. Very, very, very recently, we introduce immersive design, where in a completely immersive environment, you can collaborate, but also design. But now there were still room for other improvement, and we introduce cognitive augmented design. What do we mean by cognitive augmented design? Very simple. Science, cognition, augments the capability of human being to create innovative design. Science today, it's in what we will show you, it's just about, which is not bad, structural analysis, finite element analysis for structural use cases. Later on, very, very soon, we'll use computational fluid dynamics, CFD. After, maybe thermal. After, maybe multiphysics optimization. And probably sooner, we will also introduce artificial intelligence. This is what we mean by cognitive augmented design. Why it is a revolution, you will see and you will understand later on during my presentation. Remember, instead of starting from a blank sheet of paper, a sketch where you have no real ideas, the main concept here is to start from specification. You have a given allocated space. You know what are the forces, the loads, the boundary condition applied to this so-called design space. You know the material, stainless steel, titanium, aluminum, polymer, and you ask CATIA to propose some concept starting from those design specifications. Forget the sketch, forget the pad, forget the fillet, forget the pocket, forget the holes. You just give the design space, the specification. CATIA generates some concept, and then depending on the manufacturing process you selected to actually manufacture the part, casting, forging, milling, additive manufacturing, CATIA helps you to adapt the shape of the concept to match the constraints coming from the selected manufacturing process. Remember, when you start to design, you never design for nothing. You have some targets, maybe you would like to reduce the weight, maybe you would like to maximize the stiffness, maybe you want to improve the durability of your part. Always a big concern is the cost produced and manufactured at a cheaper price possible. The material has an influence. So now, from that, depending on your objectives, weight, stiffness, durability, cost, materials, CUTIA will propose concept. You select the manufacturing process you would like to use to actually produce the part, depending on how many parts you need to produce. And this is where cognitive augmented design enter into the game. Let's follow the journey. Three ways to use cognitive augmented design. You start from design space, specification, concept. You start from an actual existing part that you want to modify. So the design space is just the shape of the actual part. And you use cognitive augmented design. Or you start from an assembly made of multiple parts, maybe 20 components, maybe 100 components, and you would like to reduce the number of components to minimize the cost of the maintenance and the assembling of this actual product. This is a three scenario where cognitive augmented design can be used. So let's start with the very first scenario. And I think images are better than words. And just follow me in this very, very nice journey. The idea is that I'm no longer working for Dassault Systèmes. I'm working for an aerospace engineering company. My boss told me, Daniel, you need to reduce the weight and maximize the stiffness of the part that you can see on the left part of the screen. It's in aluminum. And let's go. Let's see how CUTIA can help you to go from the part which is displayed on the right side of the screen, which is a freeform shape. Probably we will use additive manufacturing to produce it. But if it's a success, maybe we want to go no longer from 100 or 10 parts, but to 1,000, 10,000 parts. Milling will be the most appropriated manufacturing process to produce this part at a good cost. And we will show you how CUTIA can adapt the shape from the freeform shape to a millable shape with a three-axis machine. Let's go. Okay, this is my actual part, maybe a CUTIA V5 part, maybe a step 5 that I receive from my customers. I give some freedom to the part to have a little bit more flexibility in the design. CUTIA recognize the mechanical interfaces, which are displayed in blue, which are the link between the surrounding neighbor parts within the assembly. It's finite element analysis based, so I have to mesh the part, but it is really made transparent for end user, because this tool is addressing mechanical designer, not FEA experts, so it should be smooth and easy to use. Once this is done, I define my loads. In this case, I define forces at the center of gravity of the four holes, which are the mechanical interfaces of a given magnitude. I create another force on another direction with a different magnitude. I will combine those two forces in what we call load cases, which are scenarios where we can use one or the other or two forces at the same time. Once this is done, I will now define my boundary conditions. I could have clamped the part, but I will just use what we call virtual bolt, which is a more smarter contact definition, where you define the diameter of the head, the diameter of the nut, and the shear stress and the axial stiffness. Okay, CUTIA is smart enough, it can replicate your virtual bolt definition to similar diameter circles inside your part, which is what I do. Now I define what I would like to optimize, maximize stiffness, minimize mass, optimize the eigenvalue frequency. I use in this particular case, maximize stiffness, reduce the volume of the actual design space by 85%. I can select some geometrical constraints. I would like a symmetrical part, even if the boundary conditions and the load are not symmetrical. And then I can also define manufacturing constraints. For the first step, I will say no manufacturing constraints, create the form that you want. And I run my optimization. So I run a structural analysis. I run an optimization multiple times to converge to a first concept. And CUTIA show me this concept. What you see in green is just the boundary between what you can consider empty versus what you can consider as plane. Then the user with a cursor can play and get a thicker or a thinner shape. Automatically, in one click, this green finite element representation is converted into an exact solid, what we call the boundary representation solid. And of course, you can, by one click again, because we keep all the specification, loads and boundary condition where they are applied, you can validate the design. Looks like the design is okay. If it's not okay, you can easily modify the shape, and you can also refine the shape if you are satisfied. Now let's say I would like to make a variant. It's no longer a freeform shape that I'm looking for, but I will use a casting process, foundry. So I select my simulation object, copy-paste, create a new object, and just change one parameter. This part is no longer freeform, but it will be casted. So I give a pulling direction, and the cut here, we try to create a shape which has no undercut, no backdraft along the pulling direction. And as you can see, the result is completely different. But in one click again, I get a solid, exact solid, and I can validate. Third scenario, my colleagues from the shop floor, they have additive manufacturing machine. They tell me, Daniel, this is a vertical printing of your manufacturing additive manufacturing process. Please, can you type in 45 degrees, which are the angle where I do no longer need support, or I need support in the additive manufacturing process? CUTIA generate a concept, I validate, and now, very simply, I can enter into the variant manager where I will compare legacy, freeform, casting, additive manufacturing shape. There are some KPI for every single scenario, the weight, the maximum displacement, the von Mises, maximum von Mises stresses, some other parameters, some other KPIs. I can put priority, weight, to those various KPI, and CUTIA will help me to compute the best score and give me some recommendation. Maybe this one is better than this one regarding the priority that you assign to the various KPI. Let's say I would like to use additive manufacturing shape. I just want first to smooth a little bit the exact solid very easily by just dragging and dropping line on my tubes. CUTIA smooths the solid very easily. It's a very easy tool, very straightforward. All the mechanical designer can pick up and use this tool very quickly. And once the smoothing is done, I just replace in my spec tree the automatic reconstructed surface by the smooth one and update my design. This is what you will see very, very soon. So as you can see, the UI is very simple. It's very straightforward. Of course, I have to mirror the part. Update, and then I have to integrate, but it is done automatically, the mechanical interfaces. This is the result of my preliminary design. So from multiple concepts, I went to a preliminary design. I can modify this preliminary design, and I can, for example, push and pull on the base mesh of the subdivision surfaces that we are using to create those freeform shapes. As I modified, one-click validation is to check that everything's fine. I'm not sure the part is really without support. Not a problem. Inside CUTIA, there is tools to look and display the area where we will need support, which were displayed in yellow. And here, it's just the experience of the engineer. He will modify a little bit the shape, add some cross members in some particular area to avoid supports. This is not automatically done. It's a mix of experience of the user and our topology-optimized additive manufacturing constraint-based software. Looks like it's good. I'm fine with that. Let's double-check how this part behaves, benchmark against the legacy part and some other variant. Looks like it's great. I'm fine with that. But my boss told me you should gain more weight. Still too heavy for me. Not a problem. Remember the line that I dragged and dropped? CUTIA automatically created circles. Those circles are parametric circles with a center and a radius. Now I will select some of the circles I would like to further optimize and tell CUTIA, okay, those are the four circles. You should not go over a given von Mises stress. You should not go over a given max displacement. So it's not only geometrical optimization, it's really finite element analysis based parametric sizing optimization. I run the computation and CUTIA again optimize no longer the topology, but in this case the parameter, the value of the parameter, the size of the parametric entities, and give me a thinner design and a less heavy design. this is done in an extension role called function-driven detail refinement. But I will come back to the packaging later on. This is my result. You will see displayed in orange the circles that have been optimized. And not only we were able to topology optimize a shape, we are able to parametrically size optimize a shape, even if those shapes are freeform, okay, which is our case actually. So the blue and the green, and sorry, and the orange are displayed. You can see here the beauty of CUTIA at work. You print the part. To print the part, you have to do some modification. So from an engineer point of view, my job is done. I tell my colleague in the shop floor, please print the part. They will have to modify the part, but you are still in the same workflow on the 3D Experience platform. Easily, they can grab the part, modify the part. For example, reduce the cylinder diameter because in 3D printing, I cannot get the right specification. So I will make it smaller because later on, it will be drilled on a drilling machine. I will add some overthickness on the flat area because later on, they will be surface mill with a 3-axis machine. But this is easily done. We are within the same exact environment. No data transfer. It's a success. I print 3 parts. The customer is happy. He wants 1,000 parts. 3D printing is, as today, not the most effective in terms of price. Let's go for a milling process. Not a problem. We have a nice wizard inside CUTIA. You give the automatically reconstructed part. It computes the bounding box, which will be the actual stock that you use on your milling machine. For every single setup direction, because typically you might need to modify the position of the stock in order with a 3-axis machine to reach all those drilling directions. And for every single setup direction, we compute the silhouette, we extrude the silhouette, we run a Boolean operation between the actual stock and the extrusion, and we do that for all those 3 directions. And at the end, you have a fully parametric feature-based solid made of constraint sketch extrude feature that not only you can, why not, parametrically size optimize like I did with a freeform shape, but of course you can easily, from the preliminary design or the concept design which is shown here, go to the more detailed design by just changing the sketch, changing some shape, replacing a funny shape by an oblong, a circle, a rectangle, a square, and very, very easily, in a couple of hours, you can get a very detailed, completely parametrically designed solid. This type of job might last 5 days without a 3D Experience CUTIA. And at the end, I can compare my various design for milling, the legacy design, and the part that has been designed to be additive manufactured, thanks to the variant manager. Here we go. What you saw here done on a part can be, in fact, also done on an assembly. It's the exact same stage that we are going through. I take an assembly. I select a given position of my assembly, and CUTIA will help you to process one part, every single part, sorry, of the assembly, one after the other. You do the exact stage, the same stages. You define the mesh value. You define the material, very important. You define the boundary condition and the loads for every single part at this given position of the assembly. You define manufacturing constraints. You define geometrical constraints. CUTIA will mesh the part, run the optimization, propose concept. You can play with the concept to study multiple variants. And when it is done, CUTIA will generate the exact solid that you can later on further refine depending on the manufacturing processes you selected. Here, I will just speed up a little bit. These are the results of what has been done on the complete structure of the assembly. And the part, and the assembly, and the product at work. But some guy in the finite element design office told me, Daniel, in some areas of the parts, there are too much stress. There are peak of stress, which could be okay for 1 year in of service of the part, but are not okay if the part should last longer. Let's see how we can get rid of those peak of stress. So we have the part, and those are the area with peak of stresses, okay? Now, inside function-driven detail refinement extension role, the one I use for the parametric sizing optimization, we have also a very nice tool to do shape optimization. It's not a global optimization, it's local optimization. You really want to get to remove peak of stress, usually that you can find inside fillets, which are tangent fillets, and you want to bump a little bit those fillets to reduce the maximum stress value. Here, what you have to do as a user is just select the area, or let's say partition the area where you want to locally modify the shape. This is what is done and what is shown here in dark gray. And cut here, after having mesh again the part and inputting some parameters, like what you would like to optimize, what is the maximum stress acceptable, do you accept to let a small increase of the mass? Why not? In my case, I accept 5%. And I will run my shape optimization. Again, I can run it in the background. So during this computation, which can last maybe 5, 10, 20 minutes, I can continue to use my CUTIA to do some other task. And once the result of the once the computation is done, CUTIA show you the convergence plot to see that on both mass and max stress, everything is fine, and we'll show you the result. In my particular case now, everything is fine. I reduce the max stress, the peak of stress. And in this situation, in fact, I even reduce it by 50%. I reduce it by 2, which is very, very good result. And my boss accepts my job. Thank you, boss. So you saw the workflow. It's a very cool workflow. Legacy data or design space, freeform shape, optimize freeform shape, shape optimize freeform shape, but I can also reconstruct a model for milling. So I will show you a quick example how we can do that to reduce the number of parts into one single assembly. Very, very similar process. This is here on the upper left corner, the actual assembly. I create a design space. I run the various stages of my cognitive augmented design. And in my particular case, I create 3 variants, freeform for additive, milling and casting. And then, depending on my customer, I selected one of the other manufacturing process. If now we look at the complete workflow, which is not only smooth, but very cool and very efficient, you go from the design space, a solid. You prepare your specification, loads, boundary condition, material. CUTIA generate a concept. In one click, you get a solid. You validate this solid. You maybe start to evaluate other alternatives, variants, one for casting, one for milling, one for whatever, or additive manufacturing. You can compare them with the variant manager, and then you are assisted by CUTIA to reconstruct and adapt the automatically reconstructed solid for additive manufacturing or milling, for example. And those are the unique capability of CUTIA, exact solid generation. It's not a mesh, it's not an STL file, it's not a polygonal model. Trade-off variant management and the assistant to help you to reconstruct a part adapted to the manufacturing process you selected. Finally, you can go even further, run parametric sizing optimization on both freeform shape and or the feature of your part that has been reconstructed for milling. And you can even go further to do a shape optimization to avoid or to minimize the maximum stress inside some local area of your part, Once this is done, you can validate. And here, one of our unique capabilities is to do parametric sizing optimization on freeform shape. The takeaway, hopefully you understood what we meant by cognitive augmented design. Hopefully you understood that it's a real revolution. And don't miss it. Many thanks for your attention. But I think Anne has some questions that has been raised by you guys and you ladies. So how can I help you, and what are those questions?
Great, yes, I go to your questions. And the first one from our users is this available in CATIA V5?
The answer is no. Unfortunately, we have so much technology embedded in 3D Experience CATIA to get to this result that it's not possible to do that in V5. That's the bad news. But the good news is that, and we have a lot of customers doing that, they are using CATIA V5 for their design, but they use 3D Experience CATIA to just take benefit of the cognitive augmented design, and you can easily pass back the model that has been created with cognitive augmented design back to V5 and continue your actual process.
Fine. And since which release of the 3D Experience CATIA is this available?
So it's a 2 years baby, so it's a very new product and continue to be improved release after release at a very, very lightning speed pace. So it has been released in 2017X, which was released in November 2016.
Okay.
And we are today in 2019X.
Yeah. And what kind of mesh control do we have? Can you optimize against multiple loading conditions simultaneously?
So yeah, there are two questions in your question. And the first question is, yes, we can control a little bit the mesh parameters. It's not a tool for FEA expert. It's a tool for designers. So two type of element, tetrahedra or hexahedra, and we have two type of behavior, linear or cubic. And you can, of course, change and use or define the size of your element. Now, to answer your second question, Anne, yes, we can have multiple forces that we can combine multiple load cases, and the optimization will be run simultaneously.
Great. And the next question is this available both on-premise and on the cloud?
Yeah, it's a beauty of 3D Experience CATIA. Most of 3D Experience CATIA role are available both on-premise or on the cloud. I really like the cloud. It's very, very convenient. You have nothing to install on the server side, no backup. No, you just forget what is IT, and you can connect as long as you have an internet connection. You can connect from everywhere and continue your job and share your job.
Really easy. And can we export the output of this to subdivision surfaces and edit later to make it more aesthetically pleasant?
Maybe I was not very, very good in my presentation, but in fact, in CATIA 3D Experience, we are using subdivision surfaces already. When you saw the automatically reconstructed surfaces, those are subdivision surfaces. And if you can export them to other tools where you can use this technology to modify if you want. But we have also, I hope you saw that in the video, we have very, very nice tool to do this refinement inside CATIA.
Okay. And is the functional generative design module the only 3D experience module necessary to go through the whole loop like you just did?
In fact, I told about that in the presentation. The role that I showcased was function-driven generative design. This is one role, but I also use an essential role called function-driven detail refinement. The trigram is DOF, which helps me to do parametric sizing and local shape optimization.
Okay. Well, that's it for our user questions. So thank you very much, Daniel, for your presentation.
Thank you to you, Anne.
You're welcome. And thank you to you all for attending this webinar. And talk to you next time for the next webinar.
Thanks again. Have a nice day. Have a nice evening. Bye-bye.